Good morning and welcome back to another episode of The Joy of Mathematics. I'm Toby and today we're going to be talking about the world of white holes. You might have heard of black holes before, these scary sinks of gravitational potential from which nothing can escape. Black holes were predicted to exist a long time ago, and then scientists eventually found evidence that they do exist. Well, white holes are kind of like the opposite of black holes. They are born in the depths of a black hole, where time dances backwards. Nothing can enter a white hole, but everything inside of it will eventually be pushed out. For now, white holes remain just a mathematical prediction, and we haven't detected any. But thinking about white holes helps us to understand the physics in a deeper way. This video was inspired by Carlo Rovelli's latest book, White Holes, and thank you to Riverhead Books for sending me a copy. The book doesn't try to convince you that white holes exist, because they might not. Instead, it talks about what it is like to play in the mathematical sandpit of these abstract ideas, abstract as a white hole, and what it means to think about them and to research them. Rovelli's book will be available wherever books are sold in the US from the 31st of October, and that book will help you to understand these concepts in a deeper way. Black holes are as abundant as the stars that twinkle in the night sky. In fact, many black holes are formed from dying stars. When stars are alive, they are radiant, burning hydrogen. Every day's a good day when you're a star. You could imagine them singing for billions of harmonious years. But eventually, they will have a bad day. Their fuel is steadily running out, turning into helium and other elements. When the most enormous stars run out of fuel, they collapse under the irresistible pull of gravity, becoming black holes. Matter isn't swallowed into oblivion. Instead, it spirals inward towards the central star within the black hole. There, it continues to exist, even though light from this matter cannot escape to the outside. It is enveloped in mystery, held prisoner by a gravitational pull. Black holes are often portrayed like this. It's what looks like 2D flat space warping into a funnel, but this isn't the whole picture. This common drawing is not a mistake, but a happy accident, born from the need for simplicity. Given that stars are spherical, their collapsed version is also spherical. The event horizon, the point of no return, is not a circle, but instead is a sphere. If we were inside a black hole, we would find ourselves trapped in ever smaller spheres as we sunk deeper into its depths. Drawings like this are missing a dimension. To become more accurate, every circle should actually be a sphere. The spheres would be overlapping on top of each other, like a Russian doll. Drawings like this are more of a map of gravity's well. From the center, it would require an enormous amount of energy to climb out. And since black holes are symmetrical in all directions, this slice is okay to represent the entire sphere. We can paint a horizon with a single brushstroke. It signifies the boundary of our sight, separating water from sky. A ship sailing over the horizon won't stop existing once it passes it, and the sailors wouldn't notice. It's just us onlookers back on the beach who will think the boat has disappeared. The same is true for the horizon of a black hole. If our friend Carlo was to travel to a large black hole and manage to cross the event horizon, he wouldn't even notice. Supermassive black holes are large enough that changes in gravity are spread out, and they are less likely to hurt you. It's only the small black holes you need to worry about. They could turn you into spaghetti because gravity's well is very steep. Carlo's watch continues ticking at its normal rate, but to us, watching from the outside, he would slow to a stop. Past the horizon, Carlo would disappear from our sight because the light from him could no longer reach us. But Carlo himself would be happily bobbing along deeper into the black hole. Many textbooks condemn whoever enters a black hole, but don't worry, Carlo could come out again. He just needs to find another way out, and that happens to be via a white hole. Einstein gifted us the idea that gravity is the distortion of space-time, where the space-time grid represents events, each with a position and a time. So the gravity well of a black hole can be represented by a funnel of space-time. And as the black hole ages, the shape changes, lengthening and growing narrower with the passage of time. We only know this thanks to Einstein's equations, which illuminate that which would otherwise be invisible to us. Einstein's equations do have a limitation though. They can't be used to describe extreme conditions. And for the black hole, things do get extreme. As the diameter of the funnel narrows, the cylinder becomes more curved, like a roll that is rolled tighter and tighter. This distortion of space-time is so severe that Einstein's equations no longer work. Luckily though, quantum physics can save us. When it rains and water falls from the sky, it doesn't fall in one continuous flow. Instead, it falls in millions of tiny individual droplets. Each happy little droplet could be called a quanta of rain, where the word quanta means the smallest unit that makes up a whole. Now let your imagination wander to light. It too can be thought of as a shower of light drops instead of a continuous flow. These individual bundles or quanta of light are what we are describing with quantum physics. We could also think about splitting space itself up into quanta. If each little piece of space-time is like a grain of sand, then together they make up the beach of our universe. The inside of a black hole cannot be squashed any further than the size of the individual grains of space-time. This is where Einstein's equations stop working. Here, space is distorted on the quantum level. If I drop a ball, it falls to the ground, then bounces back up. In a black hole, space-time is falling upon itself, so shouldn't it also be able to bounce back? When a ball bounces, it's as if a film of its fall were being played in reverse. If we played a film of a black hole in reverse, what would we see? We would see the star and space-time bouncing back. We would see a white hole. A white hole is a black hole played backwards in time. Quantum physics links the two space-times because the transition occurs when space is squashed beyond its granular limit. In quantum physics, things don't always have a position. They can be nowhere, living in a haze of probabilities. This fact allows particles to leap or tunnel through space. And grains of space themselves might also be able to leap, flipping a black hole to a white one. In a black hole, you can enter but not leave. And in a white hole, you can leave but not enter. Anything that enters a black hole can dance with the limits of space and time before passing into a white hole and coming out again. An unsettling thought is that from the outside, we can't easily distinguish a black hole from a white one. One may expect that with the hands of time running backwards, that the pull of gravity would turn into a push, but that's not the case. In a film of the solar system being run backwards, the sun still pulls the planets in a cosmic embrace. Nothing can cross the horizon and enter a white hole, but watching from afar, we never see anything cross the horizon and enter a black hole either. To us, Carlo's time would appear to slow as he approached the horizon of a black hole, crawling to a stop. It would seem to take an infinity for him to cross the horizon, and even if we stayed up late, we'd never catch it. With black and white holes appearing the same from afar, we are reminded of the importance of looking beyond what can be immediately seen. We might not be correct about white holes. They might not exist at all, or have properties that we weren't anticipating. One idea is that a black hole and a white hole could be linked, forming a kind of wormhole between two universes or two regions of space, bridging across the fourth dimension. The scientists who have given us these ideas have done their best to paint accurate pictures, but all paintings require a bit of creativity, and in that way, scientists are artists. I think there's an artist hidden at the heart of every one of us. You too can paint inspiring pictures. So how would you imagine the inside of a white hole? Having doubts is okay. That's the thrill of science. Always wondering if what you've done is correct, with uncertainty growing into new, bigger ideas. Carlo Rovelli is a physicist who has spent much of his life studying the quantum aspects of space and time, and his book White Holes is not just about explaining the scientific ideas, but is also about the mind of a scientist at work. He mentions other ideas of white holes, including that the Big Bang, which created this universe of ours, could have been a white hole that was formed from a collapsing universe bouncing back. Rovelli writes in a very poetic way that can communicate the ideas of physics to someone who doesn't know much about it, but also can offer new perspectives for someone who knows a lot already. There's a link to order a copy of his book down in the description. Thank you to Riverhead Books for sponsoring this video, and thank you for watching. I hope that you have an absolutely mathematical day. Thanks for watching this video, and thanks to my Patreon supporters for making it possible. A special shout out to today's Patreon Cat of the Day, Cassini.